a comment, a deep lesson from this, is that when gravity emerges from a theory that doesn't have it, as in this duality, it has to be holographic, which means it has to be fundamentally non-local in a way which we've not seen previously in physics. The basic degrees of freedom in which a theory of quantum gravity is written, well, if I have some volume, the basic degrees of freedom in which the theory of quantum gravity is written is not in terms of degrees of freedom that are local or approximately local in the volume, but they have to live on the surface, as in this nice picture of a Tufts showing pixels, Planck-sized pixels on the horizon of a black hole. And there are many clues to this. There's the Weinberg-Witten theorem, which seems to forbid emergent gravity. And the way it works is that there's a mismatch between the observables in general relativity and special relativity. And the clue to evading the Weinberg-Witten theorem is to realize this mismatch goes away if the gravitational theory has an extra dimension. The black hole entropy, which says that, well, that the states of a black hole are counted by its area, not its volume, and moreover, that this is sort of the most entropic thing you can have in a theory of gravity. And the black hole information paradox, which is another long story, but where, okay, so Hawking uncovered this paradox and argued that it required a breakdown of the laws of quantum mechanics. And we no longer believe that, so you can say he was wrong, but he was right about the important thing, which is that this paradox is very deep, and it points to a fundamental breakdown in some principle of physics. And the principle we now think of that breaks down is not, in fact, quantum theory, but locality, that information can, in some sense, be both inside and outside at the same time because there is no sharp meaning, again, to where it is. And it's an issue of locality, not quantum physics, when I say that. So constructing gravity in this way allows, so basically this box is anti-de Sitter space. It's another picture. I drew this. The picture on the first slide was drawn by someone with some artistic sense. This is a very schematic and pragmatic picture. But what it captures is that anti-de Sitter space is like a box. It's a box that can hold gravity. And you know that when you do physics, it's often useful to put your system in a box when you start so you can control everything. And within this box, you can do lots of thought experiments, Hawking's thought experiment, high energy scattering, other thought experiments. And actually, you could do more than thought experiments in principle because the formulation is all in terms of a gauge theory. You could actually simulate these experiments on a computer numerically. That's hard because there are many degrees of freedom, but there is real progress being made in simulating the gauge theory duals of these gravitational theories. And it teaches you lessons, and this is I won't go through the list, but over the years, thinking about gravity, people have, from various points of view, argued that the theory of quantum gravity must have one or another property. Again, that quantum mechanics must break down, or Lorentz invariance must break down, or other things. And this gives a construction of quantum gravity which violates certain prior arguments, which shows that the things that one thought a quantum gravity theory might not be able to do, this theory does. And in that way, it's already been valuable in understanding quantum gravity. And there's a lot of open questions. One of the biggest is to derive this duality. So the argument for it is circumstantial. It was first discovered by coincidences between seemingly very different calculations, which are similar to the coincidence between the strange metal and the geometric picture that I had on my first picture. And there's a very long list of kinds of evidence, very diverse, but there's no derivation. And this is I think this is something we should always remember. And this is not the only duality for which this is true. There are string-string dualities. There are even field-field dualities. And it may tell us that there is still something very deep that we don't understand even about quantum field theory. That maybe instead of thinking about it as so John today talked about this theory of quantum field theory which doesn't have a Lagrangian. It cannot be described by our usual tools for constructing quantum field theories. And this may be a clue that there is some other way to think about quantum field theory that we haven't found yet. There are technical problems of just that we have a large number of anti-de Sitter vacua in the string landscape, the landscape of sort of possibly physically interesting string theories, for which we don't have the field theory dual. They must exist in principle, but the technology is actually pretty limited for constructing these. Again, finding Hawking's mistake. Hawking was right that something broke down, but finding, in fact, how in his original calculation the Hawking radiation remains pure, extending, oops, that didn't come out quite right, but anyway, the biggest question is, again, that this works specifically for gravity in a box. And we don't live in a box. We live in an expanding universe. And again, this is another, I didn't draw it, but I could have because it's not very pretty, attempt to represent the very large scale structure of our universe. And there are no walls, at least not visible to us. We're not in a box. There's some kind of mysterious, singularish beginning. And probably in the future, there is some chaotic, highly inhomogeneous, set of bubbles of baby universes, if you want to call them, with different physics. Anyway, this is what our universe may look like on a grand scale. And how does one extend the holographic principle to a theory which says that gravity lives on the boundary to a theory that has gravity but no boundary? Is that the boundary? Or is that the boundary? Or do we have to somehow generalize the way we think about what the holographic principle is? OK, so now we get to the technical part of the talk. And I have almost no time left, which is good. 5 minutes, OK. So just briefly, attempts to address some of those questions. So one knows that there are certain necessary conditions for a quantum field theory to have a gravitational dual. It has to have many fields, and it has to have strong coupling. And these correspond to the fact that the space, the box, has to be big compared to the Planck scale in order that quantum gravity be weak, be nearly classical. And it has to be large compared to the string scale in order that we have geometry and not string theory. And these are necessary conditions, but it seems plausible that they might also be sufficient conditions if formulated sufficiently precisely, because these are, especially this condition of large anomalous dimensions for most fields, is a very constraining condition and a very unusual one. And I can just say there are partial results that in a model with a very small number of low dimension operators, we can actually do something which one can rarely do in quantum field theory, which is construct it axiomatically, solve the axiomatic conditions, especially crossing that the theory must solve, and find the most general solution. And the conjecture is true at this level. The solutions are in one-to-one correspondence with the local bulk actions. I think this is an interesting step, but I have to tell you that the work involves lots of hypergeometric functions. And detailed properties of hypergeometric functions. And I think there should be a much more physical way to get to such a broad physical result. And so the second attempt, which is to try to exploit something which many people have discussed, but I think there's still more to say about it, which is the connection between evolution in the radial direction of Method of Sitter space and the Wilson renormalization group flow. And one reason to think this is a way to proceed is because, again, the distinctive property of these conformal field theories, they have very few low dimension operators. And that's some information about their renormalization group flow. And so maybe that's the right way to package what one is trying to do in a physical way. And again, the goal here, the real goal is holography is mysterious. You have the degrees of freedom written on the boundary, and yet the physics is local in the bulk, or almost local. It fails to be local in interesting ways. And one wants to understand how that locality emerges. Anyway, this is still, we haven't gotten to where we hope to go. We've developed the parallels between radial evolution and Wilson flow and gotten some surprises, maybe not surprises to everybody, but surprises to us, that the flow necessarily involves the full space of multi-trace operators, not just the single trace operators, as one often focuses on. There's an interesting fact about how one has to treat the metric. One doesn't, as one might think, when you integrate out sort of half of a space, you usually encounter the will-do-it equation for the metric on the boundary, and one needs to do it actually in a gauge-fixed form. The real question is, so here's anti-de Sitter space, a different, this is my third picture of anti-de Sitter space. They all look different, but they all capture different aspects of it. The real question is, we know that if we have field gravity in this big space, it's a field theory on the boundary. If we put gravity in this smaller space, in what sense, if any, is it captured by some cutoff field theory, some field theory with fewer degrees of freedom on this smaller boundary? We don't know. The work I described suggests a possible but very abstract answer in terms of the ultimate quantization of the field theory anyway. So to conclude, this duality implies really unexpected connections between widely divergent parts of physics. For string theory itself, it confirms in some ways that it's just a stepping stone, but it also tells us that it's not such a new thing. It was hidden all along inside Yang-Mills theory, if we only had known how to decode it. I mean, finally, that the final form of quantum gravity is still mysterious. But one thing I think will almost certainly be true is that it will be holographic, which means that whatever language it is finally written in, that language will be non-local in a fundamental way, and locality, like gravity, will be emergent. So, thank you.